A very good evening to you all. This is your host, Dr. George Noel Fernandez, founder of GA Medical Advisory Services, the company that helps hospitals grow to help improve their clinical services, their clinical excellence, patient care, and the quality of care. Today, we are going to be speaking with Mr. Alok Awasthi, founder of SeekMed, on the topic of the great acceleration of telemedicine, reshaping health and social care. Access to healthcare ranks among the top challenges facing the rural communities today due to the provider shortages, long travel distances, and the acceleration of hospitals closure in the recent years because of the COVID times. While not a paradigm, virtual health can address many of these issues and in turn help narrow the rural-urban health disparity and the divide. The sharp disparity between access to care and the overall health of citizens in rural areas compared to their urban pathways is quite wide. Digital health has been widely anticipated to change the face of healthcare for many years. Substantial growth in investment, M&A, and IP activity in the space has brought increased confidence that the time for digital health has come. But no company activity, product launch or event has been as convincing for the case of digital health as the global COVID-19 pandemic. Because of the pandemic, healthcare systems around the world have turned towards digital tools supported by government initiatives, temporary relaxation of the regulations, and change in reimbursements. So welcome, Dr. Welcome, Alok. How is everything in New Jersey?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. George, for the introduction. And well, everything is good here. And as you probably are hearing in the news, corona cases are going up. So it is time to not be relaxed about taking precautions. We need to take everything that is in our control until the vaccines are out. And you hit it on the nail when you talked about the challenges that India is facing and pretty much all developing countries in terms of the healthcare, which is around the affordability and accessibility and the quality of care. So thanks for having me on this session today.
Alok, if you can briefly introduce the services of your company, tell us a bit more about your company and how is it a differentiator than any other services that are being provided?
Yeah, so SeekMed, it's a global telemedicine platform that connects patients from around the globe with India's award-winning, highly credible doctors, super specialists from the comfort of their homes. So we have several award-winning doctors on our platform who have Padma Shri's and Padma Bhushan, Dr. B.C. Roy Awards. And they come from India's highly rated top hospitals and medical institutions such as AIIMS and CMC Vellore. So it's really a platform that brings best in technology and best in medicine together. And it's a second opinion platform where we encourage patients to seek out second opinion with our super specialist doctors when in need. And it's about empowering our patient community. So on one hand, we provide telemedicine services, and on the other, we provide a patient education platform so that patient gets well informed about their medication, their treatment, their conditions, and take better control of their medical decisions. So that's in nutshell about what SeekMed is about. It is a global platform, as I said. So we have patients coming from not just India, but also from Bangladesh, from Nigeria, as well as from many developed countries.
I see there's a lot of passion in what you are doing in the work that you have. Is there something very personal that really drove you to get on this and get on this particular platform to make it available to other people?
Yeah, indeed there is. There's a personal story behind it. Several years ago when my son was very young, he was couple of months old. He was diagnosed with a condition called craniosynostosis, which is a condition where the skull of the baby is hard and it doesn't allow the brain, while it is expanding, to find enough space to grow. The solution for that is to provide a surgery to take out a piece of bone from the skull. So we were consulting with one of the best pediatric neurosurgeon in New York, but I wanted to consult, get a second opinion, consult with an Indian doctor. And despite many attempts, we could not get connected with a good pediatric neurosurgeon. And that happened to me, you know, who is, I mean, I consider myself a resourceful person and well-informed. So imagine this is happening to a person who is living in a small towns or villages. So it's not easy to find or get connected with a good doctor, with a super specialist doctor. So that started the whole thinking. And fortunately, I got in touch with a senior cardiologist, Dr. T.S. Clare from Delhi, and he's a Padma Bhushan awardee. He agreed to be our medical advisor. And then we gave it a shape of a telemedicine platform where people can come and get second opinion and discuss their medical, complex medical conditions where they're looking for more comfort before going for those tough decisions for themselves or for their family members.
So, Alok, I think so. This is an excellent, I think, your idea and how you're developing it. You're getting the best of the best doctors to be there on this particular platform to give people another opinion just to ensure that they're getting the best medical services. Something that excited me on your website was two things. One is data security and also on your medical library. Would you be able to speak about that?
Yeah, that is, thanks for bringing this up. Data security is one of the, I would say, pillars of developing a technology platform. So as you can imagine, healthcare is something that deals with people's lives. So data security is something which has been talked about a lot, especially in developed economies. We have, for example, in US, we have laws, you know, dedicated to patient data privacy called HIPAA laws. We have GDPR in European Union. I think in India also, we are coming up with some regulation around this. So how we use patient data is very important, and how we secure that data is very important in terms of developing a technology platform. And this not only gives confidence for the patient community in terms of how their data is being used, but also it provides a credibility, because here we are talking about a healthcare sector, so that the data is not misused. And the data, it could be financial data, it could be their personal data. So every possible measure should be taken by technology leaders to prevent the misuse of their confidential data. So, so at SeqMed, we have adopted measures, both in terms of technology as well as our internal processes, so that the data of the patient remains secure. And it's part of our culture that we have formed within our team to make sure that when we connect with patients, data security is something that we consider as topmost priority.
Perfect. How in this particular pandemic you have been able to integrate the telemedicine? Any other initiatives that you will have done? Technology enabled approaches to take care of the patient. Would you be able to put a highlight on that?
Yeah, sure. So one thing this pandemic has done is that it has really pushed telemedicine forward. Many people, especially in developing countries in India, they were not aware of what this term is about. So government, as you indicated, government has eased regulations, which helped a lot. So government has not only eased regulation, but also pushed forward the idea of telemedicine so that more and more people connect with their healthcare providers from the comfort of their homes. It also eases the burden on our hospitals. So at SeqMed, we use both asynchronous as well as synchronous telemedicine services. So synchronous is where doctor and patient come together for a video call. They see face to face and they interact on a real time basis. Asynchronous is where we use a store and forward approach, where a patient shares the medical history or the reports or scans with the doctor for more like a evidence-based treatment. So it's a combination of the two. And very recently, we also launched India's largest health portal, Health Library, that shows pretty much any condition, any treatment that you can think of from head to toe. You'll find detailed information out there in that library that has been reviewed by doctors in US. And as I indicated, patient education is one of the pillars of healthcare, along with affordability, accessibility, and quality. So this is something that we're very passionate about. We believe that a well-informed patient leads to better outcomes. In fact, there have been some research done in US where a Gallup survey, I believe, where 72% of those patients who were told what to expect post-surgery, they were found satisfied with the outcomes compared to those who were not informed about what to expect. Only 39% were satisfied with the results. And it not only leads to better patient outcomes, but also it helps with containing the readmission cost at the hospitals. The cost is staggering. In the United States, it is $17 billion for the cost of readmission. And I'm sure in India also the number will be very high. And they've done a research where this cost can be cut down by 5% just by focusing on patient communication. So this is another attempt to inform, to educate our patients so that when they go in front of the doctors, they ask the right questions and be involved in the overall treatment process.
Today, there's a lot of talk about personalized healthcare, personalized management, and also the use of technology to help guide the patient or guide the doctor also in delivering the right treatment. And so that like a lot of medicine is today, what we're looking at is algorithm-based medicine. Is this some way in the system to either guide the patient to say, you need a cardiac surgeon of this particular caliber, or to see that he or she is getting the right treatment, or to help guide the doctor to, in a sense, you might need maybe a CT scan, or certain investigation?
So a lot of research is being done, especially around and new advanced technologies are being incorporated in this domain. A lot of artificial intelligence-based capabilities are being incorporated that advises patients in terms of identifying what their problem might be, because many times patients, when they come to us, they don't know which doctor they should consult. So these kind of AI-based capabilities can advise the patients who is the right doctor to consult to. And then combined with more specific treatment, so you don't have a generic version of recommending to the patient, but more specific based on their age and gender and demographic details. So those are things which are actively being explored by various technology platforms. And combine that with the wearables and the monitors, so that provides opportunities for both doctors and patients to be more connected in terms of getting patients' vitals and sharing those with the doctors. And this saves time, and this this provides makes it easier for the patient information to be shared with the doctor on a more real-time basis. So I think we'll see more and more of such capabilities to come in near future. I was reading one article recently that some researchers in US, they've developed an AI-based tool that can detect COVID-19 based on the nature of your cuff. So these kind of things, I think, will become more common as we look at further strengthening or using technology in the healthcare sector.
So as you're developing your platform, I mean, I would just like to understand, how are you evaluating patients with potential exposure to COVID-19 through the telemedicine?
So let me first tell your viewers that telemedicine platforms should not be used for emergency situations. So if, let's say, a COVID patient has developed a breathlessness or not able to breathe properly because of lack of oxygen, then these are the cases that must be reported immediately to the nearest hospital. For other cases where we have mild symptoms in the patients, patients can connect, consult with our internal medicine specialist, and the doctor can advise on building immunity and taking some precautions. Since the vaccine is still a few months away, and we'll find out what the efficacy of these vaccines are going to be. So at the moment, what doctors are doing are to provide them some guidance and precautions, what these patients can do. And also provide them relief, because many people are not suffering from physical problems, but they're suffering from anxiety and mental problems. So we get both sorts of cases, and our psychiatrists connect with our patient community and the patients and their advice how to deal with this crisis. And provide them relief. So these are the two cases that we are getting on a regular basis.
Yeah, in my last conversation with you, you were looking at, you were telling me about how you're providing total comprehensive services with labs and pharmacies, so that the patient who's getting a teleconsult, he really does not have to go out of his house. So if you can just explain to our viewers the complete process, if I want to just book a consultation with you, do I have to be a member, or how does this thing work, and how do you add on other services in terms of the pharmacy and lab so that me as a patient does not have to go out of the house?
Yeah. And this is very relevant in these times. I mean, just imagine, I mean, you're based in Delhi, but just imagine you are based in Port Blair or in a city in Northeast. With not much access to big hospitals or good doctors. So telemedicine, in order to get services, you need to get registered first on a platform, create a profile, patient profile, provide, capture all the details, including your allergies, blood group, and or any medication that you're taking. We connect these patients with the doctors based on what particular problem they're facing. Post-consultation, if a doctor has prescribed some medication, we have partnered with the 1MG to provide online medicine delivery for these patients. If the doctor has advised some diagnostic or lab services, then we have tied up with Dr. Lal Pathla, for example, so that they can go to your home and then collect your blood sample and then provide your report right at your doorstep. And then the same reports could be uploaded back in the system so that the doctor can review it and then provide an informed decision or the treatment plan. So these are some of the areas which will make patients' life much easier so that they don't need to go out of their homes and as much as possible. And then definitely it cuts down on all the travel and all the hassles that come with traveling to a metro area or traveling to a large hospital. Even if you're living in Delhi, I mean, if you have to travel from one part of Delhi to let's say a large hospital in central Delhi, it pretty much takes the entire day. And just imagine if you are 60 plus, 70 plus, and physically not in that position to travel, it creates a lot of hassles. It exposes the patient to a lot of germs and other things that are there in the hospital. So it's a safe way to consult and remain connected with your doctors.
I am given an understanding India has been your first kind of venture where you're really putting this platform based out of India and really trying to make it on a global space. And you were talking to me yesterday about really getting a number of patients from Bangladesh and from neighboring countries who are now using this platform, which is excellent. I would like to understand correctly, how's the role of the government in deploying the digital services in India compared to the country that you are currently based out of in the US? So what's the difference and advantages, disadvantages?
So one thing that I see is a major difference in the way a typical patient in a developing economy deals with healthcare versus those from developed economies. Patients in developed economies are, in most of the cases, are very well informed. They know about their doctors. They know about their medical conditions at the greatest level of detail. Plus, above all, they also know about their medication and the medicines. Many times they question the doctors, why this particular medicine and why not the other. So that information is very much available everywhere in developed economies. Now, in developing countries like India, for example, take this telemedicine. Government of India has pushed a lot. They not only eased the restrictions, but also pushed a lot to use telemedicine. But this term itself was not known to many outside large cities. Telemedicine, what does it mean? What does it stand for? It was not known. And healthcare, since it is based on trust, so it required government's push to convey to the patient community that it is okay to leverage telemedicine services. Government of India also recently launched the National Digital Health Mission, where they will be creating health IDs. And they started with the 6 pilot projects. I'm hearing that now they're getting ready to launch it across all the states. So this will create really the largest database that you can think of around the globe. And this is really, I think, no other country except for maybe Sweden or some of the, few other European countries, they have attempted this kind of thing. So this will create a large database. This will make it easier for patients, especially coming from rural backgrounds, to get access to the healthcare anywhere in India. It will make things easier around the payments and the costs and the any insurance that they have. And it will generate huge amount of data that the government can use to further implement specific policy programs for a particular geographic region in India. So I think these are things which were required, especially in India, to convey the message. And like I said, I mean, this healthcare is based on trust. So if the message comes from the government that it's okay to explore telemedicine services, then people will come out more and more and leverage these services. And that's what we are finding these days as well.
Yeah, I think so. The government has really done well, especially as you rightly mentioned, telemedicine was not the treatment or no the consultation of choice for most Indians till really the pandemic hit India. And only in March, when the government or the state government allowed, the state medical council allowed to have prescriptions being written through telemedicine. So I think so the government has moved forward quite a bit. And we all know that this is going to stay as part of our lives. Telemedicine is just going to be there. And we are going to be expecting more and more out of telemedicine. But what are the challenges, I mean, you would face in terms of ethics or in terms of any other guidelines that you would like the government to really look at when you're talking about telemedicine?
So what I'm anticipating once the COVID situation eases up is that government will come up with a more stringent parameters and regulation in terms of forming more specific guidelines. Right now, you see that doctors and patients, they're using all sorts of platforms to connect with each other. These platforms are not meant for healthcare because they don't capture your details as a patient and the details of the doctors. It doesn't capture, they don't capture the history of the patient. So they provide a real-time mechanism, and I'm referring to tools like Skype and WhatsApp. So I'm anticipating that once the vaccine is out, once we get into a more stable, stability around the COVID situation, government will share more specific details around the do's and don'ts of you're developing your technology platforms and how you can make sure that the data remains secure. What are the guidelines that need to be followed so that ultimately the patient's interests are secured. So I'm hoping more to come on this. From SeqMed's perspective, we are already ready for that situation as we've already built our technology platform around those guidelines because we are already meeting those global standards. We have patients coming from developed countries like Australia and United States and UK. So this is something that we had to do anyways.
I'm sure that you must have faced numerous challenges to reach at the point where you currently are. What is your advice to budding healthcare stakeholders, people who are entering this field? What would be your advice?
It's been an incredible journey for us and for our team. This is a healthcare sector where we deal with patients' lives. My only advice to new entrepreneurs is to have a long runway. The success will not come quick. It may take time. So they need to have plan for enough time. They need to keep in mind that it's not just about building a brand, but you're building trust with the patient community. If you keep that in mind, then you will avoid taking shortcuts, which could be detrimental to the patient community. So this would be my main, the single biggest suggestion to entrepreneurs. Of course, anyone entering the healthcare domain will be looking at other aspects of building a new business around the timeliness and the timing of launching a new product or services, the business model, those are given. They should keep a long runway. That would be my suggestion.
Alok, I totally agree with you. I think so. You really put the nail on the head by saying the trust factor, particularly when a patient is not able to see a doctor physically and is using a particular platform. Trust the platform to A, provide that his privacy is being maintained, B, that he's getting the right advice, C, that the doctor is the right doctor who he is consulting. And all his documentations are maintained because today, at the end of the day, even if I'm doing a consult physically or through telemedicine, it should remain the same. And the amount of trust this particular platform can build will really depend upon the success this platform will achieve at the end of the day. So very well said, Alok. I really like the point that you build. You took up this point on the trust. What do you think of the VOH Voice of Health healthcare broadcast?
VOH broadcast, the unique aspect of VOH broadcast that I see is that you cover a broad spectrum of stakeholders. You don't just reach out to doctors and hospitals, but also the entrepreneurs, the policymakers, the influencers. Our healthcare system faces many challenges. There are many gaps that need to be highlighted in terms of delivery mechanism, in terms of building new systems. So taking this messaging forward with the right people, you need a credible platform like Voice of Healthcare broadcast. So I've watched few of these sessions in the past, and it's really, really incredible, the work that VOH is doing. This is the need of the hour. Healthcare requires a very focused attention, and I think VOH is playing its part in that.
Thank you. We are just running out of time, so I would like to thank Voice of Healthcare. I'd like to thank all our viewers, and especially I'd like to thank Dr. Alok Awasthi, founder SeekMed, for his time and his valuable inputs. Greatly appreciated, and we hope to have you next time on our show to really understand what else can have as this platform brought in and how much it has developed. And I do hope your viewership increases. Have a great day.
Thank you, Dr. George. Thanks for having me.